All right, just want to, relax, everybody just relax. We used to, pray until, we got a breakthrough when we come to church, that we really got the saints. And dear, how many know what it means when you get a breakthrough? That's when you start feeling good. Attack, overcome your what? Tiredness. It's not always easy to do, all right, praise God. All right, Father, we thank you for your love, your goodness, and all of your blessings, your benefits, and your goodness to us, and all that you've done for us through Jesus. And we thank you, Lord, for the provisions you've made for our salvation. You loved us with an everlasting love. Not that we love you, but you loved us. And you gave your life, you laid down your life for us. Father, we thank you, hallelujah, because of your love and kindness and tender mercies that we are here. By the grace of God, we are what we are. Lord, you are the strength of my life. You are the light of our salvation. We are complete in you. Oh, God, we thank you that you have blessed us with every spiritual blessing, everything that pertains unto life and unto godliness. You've given us peace and joy. Oh, we can enter into your courts with thanksgiving. We can enter into your courts with praise. Hey, Lord, we enter into your gates with thanksgiving and into your courts with praise. Not that we always feel like it, but this is the sacrifice of praise. Sacrifice means that we do it whether we feel like it or not. Hallelujah. Yes. Sacrifice means that we go beyond how I feel, our flesh, and all that we have experienced during the day. Lord, you still want our praise, even after we have gone through rigorous, hallelujah, all types of routines. And yes, been busy, and yes, going to and fro, involved in various duties and responsibilities. But Lord, you still the strength of my life. You are still the light of my salvation. Oh, God. You, hallelujah, you are all that we need. And our sufficiency of you. Oh, God, we thank you this evening. We bow our knees to you, Lord. You are Lord of lords, King of kings. You are the Lord God of glory. Oh, God, you are worthy tonight to receive all of the praises. Yes, all of the glory, worthy of all honor, worthy of all power. Yes, worthy of a hope to receive glory, worthy to receive strength, dominion. Lord, we thank you that you bought us, yes, with a great price. When we were dead in trespasses and sin, you reached down. Yes, brought us out of that horrible pit, out of that miry clay, set our feet upon a rock and established our goings and put a song in our hearts. Even praise to you, Lord. Hey, there's a song in my heart that the angels can't sing. Been redeemed, Yimisha. Been redeemed, been washed in the blood of the Lamb. Oh, God, we thank you. Hey, hiya, ya, ya. You're good, and your mercy endureth forever. Oh, we the redeemer of the Lord shall say so. Yes, whom you have redeemed. You have redeemed me, hallelujah. You have delivered me from the power of darkness. Translated me into the kingdom of your dear Son. Hallelujah, you brought me out of darkness into this marvelous light. Oh, God, we thank you when we were yet without strength in due time. In due time, you died for the ungodly. When we were yet without strength, you commended your love toward us. Oh, God, you gave us, beautiful ashes when we were dead in our trespasses, alienated in our minds. By wicked works, Lord, you, reconcile us unto you.
through your son, through the blood he shed, through the life he gave, through the victory he won. Hey, haya, oh God, we thank you today that we are complete in you. We are complete. We are complete. Haya, we thank you, Lord, that your grace is sufficient. Sufficient for every need. Hey, by grace we're saved through faith. Yes, that's not of ourselves, it's through the gift of God. Lord, we thank you. Yes, Lord, we thank you, God, for standing grace. Not only did you save us, yes, but you have delivered us from the power of sin. You have delivered us from the power of darkness. We thank you, Lord, hey, that we are free. He the Son set free shall be free. Hey, we are crucified with you. Nevertheless, we live, neither holler is not me anymore. But it's the Christ that lives in me. I'm dead, hey, sin has no more dominion over me. Sin has no more dominion over me. Oh, hallelujah. The power of Satan over my life has been broken. I've been released. In the blood, delivered from the power of darkness, Satan is defeated. He's under my feet. Hey, hallelujah! He's under my feet. He's under my hand. He's a defeated foe, and I can rejoice. Rejoice, O ye lands. Fear not, O ye lands. Rejoice, and be glad. The Lord will do great things. Hallelujah. If you delight yourself in him, he'll give you the desires of your heart. Hallelujah. We thank you, Lord. Hey, for my son, Shende, for power and authority. Habahaya, power and authority over all power of enemy. Over all power of enemy. Over all power. Everybody just say, over all power. If God be for me, who can be against me? Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. Yes. Lord, we thank you tonight. Glory. Living Roma. Put the Son in our hearts. Filling us with the Holy Ghost. Yes, washing us in your blood. Hallelujah. We thank you tonight, Lord. Spirit, rejoice in Jesus Christ. We have no confidence in our flesh. Yes, and hey, we can't please God in our flesh. Father, we know that, Lord. Oh, we're going to let go. We're going to let go. We're going to let go and let you have your way. Regardless of how we feel, regardless of how tired we are, the Lord is the strength of my life. Hey, the Lord is the strength of my life. The Lord is the strength of my life. And as I praise him, as I magnify him, he begins to release his strength. Hey! His ability begins to be manifested in me. Hey! I praise you, Lord, through trials, through tribulations.
to give you those last points that we started on last week to show you
the importance of us conforming to the image of God. Something that we talked about, holiness, and the holiness is a big issue. So we're talking about holiness on Sunday. Talked about it last week. Y'all weren't here, y'all missed it. Might be able to get it through John. John is available, I guess. Amen.
Amen.
But it was holiness. And tonight, we're going to, before it's over, we're going to show you that without holiness, no man shall see the Lord. There are certain things God requires of us, and all of these issues that God requires are going to be brought into judgment. We're going to face it at the judgment seat. Amen. And if we don't face it there, we'll face it at the other end. All right. Chapter 3, Moses, a servant of the Lord, and very interesting. All of this would lead us to the point where the same disciplines and the same virtues that were manifested through these great men of God were the same virtues that were manifested through Christ. So that's God's way of actually working and fulfilling his will. He has to have certain men in place, certain people in place, and there are certain virtues that have to be manifested for God to be able to work through them and accomplish his will. And Moses was one of those men, and we're calling this chapter a servant of the Lord. Amen. Hebrews 3:5, and we just want to look at that. And Moses verily was faithful in all of his house as a servant for a testimony of those things which were to be spoken after. Amen. That's in a whole lot. Moses was faithful in all of his house. And we're going to see all of the different areas that Moses were very faithful in. And that's the reason why Moses emerged as one of the most powerful men, one of the most commanding and dominant figures of the Old Testament. And of course, we know that he was the mediator of the Old Covenant. Amen. He was a type of Christ. He knew the ways of God. And God's power was manifested through him. And the objectives of this lesson to show what it means to be a servant of the Lord. Amen. To show that preparation, submission, and obedience are vital to servanthood. Preparation, submission, and obedience. Preparation through prayer, preparation in the word, preparation through actually doing like Moses. He worked with God and he permitted God to carry out his will through his life. That's how we get to know God. We have to, not only through prayer, not only through listening to him, but working together with him. Is that right? Scripture says we're workers together what? With him. Anybody that you work with, anybody that you fellowship with consistently and communicate and do things with, you get to what? Know them very well. Is that right?
Amen.
Amen. An excellent Moses, an example of faithful servant. Of a faithful servant, an excellent biblical example of one who understood God's ways and had God's interest at heart, is going to be seen below. He is regarded as the most commanding figure of the Old Testament. He is referred to as being the servant of the Lord 18 times in Scripture. Anything mentioned 18 times in a couple of chapters, just repeatedly, Moses, a servant of the Lord. Amen. That means that a person is really committed to what? Obedience. They are submitted to the Lord, and they really are working together and carrying out God's plan for their life. Amen. Moses, a type of Christ, believed God, knew the ways of God, and carried out God's will for the nation Israel. Believed God, knew the ways of God, and carried out God's will for the nation Israel, Psalms 103. All right, Moses, this is a point that we just want to take a look at. Made a decision to respond to God's call and to forsake all other interests and ambition in which he was entitled in Egypt. Amen. And Hebrews 11:25-27 points that out. This is a scripture that all of us can really appreciate because it described Moses' disposition in terms of
laying down his life and giving up all of the earthly privileges and positions and power that he probably could have experienced. He did it all, gave it all up, just like Apostle Paul, who said, I count all but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus. Amen. Everybody that's going to be great, follow the same pattern. Paul said, I count all things but loss for the what? Excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus. Count all things but dung that I might what? Win Christ. Amen. He was a great man, a great position, a lot of credentials. He said, I consider all of these accomplishments and all of these positions, all of my education, all that I have attained as nothing. He said, my primary objective is to, I just want to what? Know the Lord. Amen. I just want to be found in him. And I want to not be operating in my works and my abilities, but I want the righteousness of God, amen, to be manifested, amen, in my life. That was Paul's attitude. But Jesus' attitude was that, amen, he relinquished all that. He said, he relinquished all of his entitlements in heaven, left his home in glory, mighty power and glory, came down in the form of a servant. Amen. Praise God. Came down in the form of a servant. After being equal with God and enjoying all of those divine prerogatives as God, he just relinquished, laid it all aside, and came down in the form. Didn't use any of these divine prerogatives that he had with the Father in his pre-existent state. But he laid them all down and came down in complete submission to what? To the Lord. Amen. Lord, whatever going to happen after I get down here on earth as a servant, Lord, you're going to have to what? Do it through. That's a good attitude, right? Amen. Jesus often said, without me, myself, amen, can do what? Nothing. He said, the works that I do are not what? Man. The doctrines that I teach are not what? Man. Amen. It's a good place. It's a good thing when we can come to the point of being completely submissive to God. Completely submissive to God. Completely dependent. How many want to be completely dependent upon God? Amen. Amen. Sometimes I look 2-bit up here. 2-bit brain says can get us into a whole lot of trouble. The Bible says that knowledge is, can be very dangerous. Amen. Praise God. So a little knowledge can really mess up a whole lot of stuff, right? Amen. But it's good to just be told. There's nothing wrong with learning education. I think that we should learn all that we can, but we should all give it to what? Give it to the Lord. And that the Lord what? Use it to his will and to his glory. And it takes prayer, so it'll take a whole lot to get to that point where you what? Let go and let God what? Do it through you. Amen. Praise God. When you let go and let God do it through you, there won't be no problem in praying. Amen. You just be skipping all over these places. Everybody that's tired, knocked out, worn out, worried, and upset over. Amen. Praise God. Got man on TV programs. Man, you, amen. You on Sky, amen. You on Cloud 13. That's when you let go and let what? God have his way. How many want to let go and let God have his way? I'm going to just propose this before Founders Day. We ought to have a night where we just call it a let go night. Amen. It's quiet now. And somebody said, well, I just don't want to let it go. I just need it all this stuff. Amen. By 3 hours, would that be good? I mean, that would be the best celebration I could have. That would be better than the dinner, Brother Chip Curtis.
Yes, it will.
If I can get all of y'all seeking God and broken through, amen, and getting complete victory in about a 3-hour prayer meeting. It might take 3 days of fasting so you can humble yourself so that you can what? Get beyond your flesh. Amen. But I would like to see that. I might just, amen, think about that and pray about that. Amen. No 3-hour prayer meeting, no Founders. Well, let me get. Hey, praise the Lord. I'm going to pray about that. It's been on you all day. I said, we ought to have a 3-hour prayer meeting and get a breakthrough once and for all. But I know there's preparation that has to be made before. You just can't come out here in 3 hours and do that. You got to what? Kind of start right now. So I'm going to start y'all out right now. All right. You want me to tell you how we can start out right now? All right, I'll take a little later. All right, so Jesus and everybody great in the Bible, they follow the same pattern of what? Submission. They gave it all to God. Because when Moses was called, did he feel qualified? Did he feel capable? Did he have what he thought he needed in order to carry out that great mission? Amen. What did Moses say when God called him to bring the children of Israel out of Egypt? What did Moses say? What was his excuse? Amen. Can't speak well. Amen.
Who's going to believe me?
There you go. Who's going to believe me? He said, I can't talk. You know you can't talk, nobody will believe.
What shall I tell them your name is?
Yeah, what shall I tell them your name is? All right. Tell them that I am that I am. I am, said he. All right. So Moses got over
Yeah,
he just didn't walk out of
it. Accept, okay, God, yeah, I accept his own.
Mm-hmm. It will take everybody a while to kind of get over your hang-ups and drawbacks and your insecurities and your feelings of inferiority.
See, God reassured him that he would be with him.
Right.
And then he also assured him that he would have someone to help him, Aaron, brother.
Right.
You know, so we're not in it alone. We
Right. So God kind of met him at the level of his faith, I guess, because when he said that I can't speak, and Moses said, well, okay. Can I speak with my brother? You can talk good. So, you know, see, like to me, God said, no. See, like to me, you know, God just kind of came down to his level of faith. And God said, well, okay, that's the way you want it. I'll talk through what? Amen. I'll talk through what? I'll talk through Aaron. Amen. So much of the communication did come through what when he came before Pharaoh. Amen, was through Aaron. Amen. So God kind of met him at his point of need. And also God dealt with his other securities because he said that to know for sure that I'm going to back you up, I'm going to do two signs. He did right up front, two signs. One of them, he had a rod, turned this rod. He said, throw your rod out. He threw that rod out, that rod turned to a snake. That's powerful, ain't it? So that was a sign that God was going to back him up, keep his word. You know, God will always stand behind his word to perform it.
Yes.
Then the second sign was that he told him, put your hand in your, is that right? Bosom. And he put it in his bosom, the hand turned leprous. It just became white as snow, that hand. He said, take it out again. Took it out again. He returned back to his original, amen, praise God, nature. So God gave him some signs. He had to work with him at his level of what? Faith. Amen. So, you know, I guess we would have said, God would have told us, since we so powerful in faith, amen. Now, since you can't talk, God said, well, I made your lips, I made your tongue. Can I make you talk? Can I speak through you? Amen. See, we would have felt like God would have expected us to, amen, to what? Be perfect and just say, well, God, can't you make me speak perfect? Amen. So some would have, you know, probably been inclined. But God didn't feel that way. He said, well, since you don't have faith, your faith ain't at that level, then I'll just work with you at your level of faith. That's good. Was that good? And God just kind of made him at this point. Okay. All right. Now, Moses was not articulate enough to be God's spokesman, trusted God to be with his mouth and to teach him what to say in his appeals before Pharaoh for Israel's release from bondage. Isn't that amazing that God had to give him exactly what to say every time they were confronting what Pharaoh trying to get the children of Israel what released? Amen. It's really good when you just have to depend on God for what? Every step.
Amen.
Amen. We depend on God for every step, every day, everything that we go through. I think that things would be entirely different. But sometimes we trust in what? What do we trust in? How do we lean? Right. We try to figure out things in our minds, right? Man, when it comes time, what should we say? Well, you know, I had a hard day. I've been through so much this week. I don't feel like standing up. I sure don't feel like opening my mouth. And I ain't gonna do it. Because, amen, I don't think it's necessary. See, I don't think it's necessary. I don't believe that God means for everybody to what? To worship Him in the Spirit and become the friend. Well, you understand that sometimes we just have a hard day. We go through things, and we don't feel like what? Raising our hands. We don't feel like offering no sacrifice. Although He says, look, let us offer the sacrifice of praise to God continually. That is the fruit of our lips. That's what the Bible says, right? So what God wants, but we rationalize and say, He didn't mean for us to do it every time. All right, let's move on. See how sometimes we just kind of reason ourselves out of obedience. Just reason ourselves. Oh, just reason ourselves. All right, so Moses knew that he couldn't reason himself out of what? His responsibilities. He had to what? Face the facts and own up to the fact that he couldn't do it in his strength. So every step of the way, he was in prayer, he was trusting God, he was looking for a word from God, and he was looking for direction, and God always spoke through him and led him in a way where he always came out to be victorious. Amen. So I like Moses. I like, you know, some can't go beyond the time that he was kicked out of the promise. I mean, he wasn't permitted to enter the promised land. So I'm saying he must have been a bad man. Yeah, he was allowed to see. He must have been a bad man. Amen. Of all of that suffering and hardship and stuff he went through, and when he got to the verge of the promised land, looked over there and looked, amen, and right at the borders of it, looked over there, and God said, sorry, Moses, I know you've been going through a struggle for 40 years. You've had a hard time with these 3.5 million rebellious folk, and they carried you through every chain imaginable. But I'm sorry, you can't make it. Amen. You can't make it. That was, so I'm saying, God wasn't. Y'all believe that God was fair? Amen. Moses, one time, amen, it wasn't, I mean, he didn't do no real bad stuff. He just obeyed, right? Amen. Anybody remember what Moses did? All right, God told him to do what? And he did what? All right, he smoked the rod. Yeah, to me, that don't seem like that's enough to kick nobody out. All right, Sister Hill said I wasn't the one to judge.
Yeah, and he didn't move them all down. Right. He instructed
them
what to do.
Right.
It's like he instructs, there you go.
Right.
He instructs us what to do.
Right.
He leaves it up to us to
right. To set a precedent so people will fear him and respect him.
And all along, too, he wanted the people, Moses knew his ways, but the children knew his act. He wanted the children of Israel to understand. It was his desire for them to know his ways as well, mm-hmm. I believe. And he wanted them to have complete dependence upon him and mm-hmm. not think. So many times we think that our ability, we're smart. You know, well, I can articulate like Aaron did. You know, I've got a half of a brain in my head, and I can think and plan and reason and do all that. And if we're not careful, we'll think that it's our ability that we are accomplishing this. And God says, no, it's not your ability. I've given you this, but I still want you to rely completely on me.
Right, rely completely.
You use what I've given you, but
Aaron was very articulate, very eloquent. Moses stammered, I guess, and he couldn't speak clearly, but he was anointed. He wholly followed the Lord.
And the man of God is also held to a higher standard.
Mm-hmm. Right, the man of God is held to what? All right, so that means that the man of God can't go to the clubs and to the casinos, right, with the regular believer can. That's debatable, isn't it? because Sister Hill, after Sundays, we had a little talk. Sister Hill said, well, certain things I can look at on TV, and it don't affect me. In the ways that might affect somebody else.
Yeah, you remember his. Yeah,
dancing with the stars. y'all took issue with me, so I'm saying.
It doesn't bother me. You know, there's nothing about that impacts me. Not from a fleshy standpoint.
There's a lot of things that don't impact you, but the Bible says that. What about forsake evil? It says.
But I was just making a point.
You're making a point.
Yeah, I was making a point that it may certain things affect certain people in different ways. And I said, it would bother me. I don't watch it. I don't think I've seen a whole program of it because it's not of interest to me.
Right.
But if I did, I would condemn anybody else for watching it. Mm-hmm. But if it becomes a stumbling block for other people, for that person, then they should look at it. But for me, it would bother me. But I'm not interested in it.
All right. Well, y'all gonna have to hear about the rest of my holiness tension. I got a whole lot more lessons to learn. So y'all keep listening. I ain't gonna deal with that right now. Y'all keep busy. I got a whole bunch of more to bring and add to that. Pile it on. Then you can look at it. But who was that said that anything, a sin in the world of this can be defined as anything that you are exposed to or you engage in that will have a tendency to cool you off spiritually? In other words, begin to impact your relationship or your fellowship with the Lord. Anything. And sometimes you can just give some stuff too much time. Amen. And sometimes give the devil an inch, he'll take what? 50 miles. So the Bible says don't give the devil what? No place. And sometimes things like that can open up the door for the devil to what? Get his little two-bit in. Amen.
Pastor, isn't there a scripture that says something to the faith? Anything that is a sin unto you is a sin. So like she was saying, if it's a sin, one person might not be a simple thing to them, but the other person, the same act, they use it in a simple way.
Okay. All right, Sister Irene came up with something very deep. Let me see if I can think of a scripture. Whosoever, he that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it is sin. That okay? Him that knoweth to do good and don't do it, to him is sin. But if you don't know, some things people don't know, they haven't been exposed to, and God doesn't hold them accountable until they get knowledge of their what? Evil. Amen. But that doesn't mean that a person is not doing all within his power to get them. Some people just can stay out of church. Every time I talk on holiness, they say, I didn't know about going to the casino.
But that's another thing. It's kind of weird what you're saying. Mm-hmm. Like, it's always kind of fast and not fast or whatever. Stand your ground. The time I fear for your life. Mm-hmm. Fear for my life might be a snake, and fear for somebody else might be jumping off a mountain. Mm-hmm. So I don't know how they're going to get this passed by trying to decide what fears to you or you or you would do and pass this law. Mm-hmm. They'll be going to the grocery store with posters on their hips and the cashier asking for the money, and that might offend them, so they'll just shoot at them.
Well, actually,
I don't understand.
Actually, we already have a law.
It's in there.
Basically, it says,
yes,
if you feel threatened for your life, you can defend yourself. Yes. So, again, that's already in effect technically, because of what one person might be like, girl, I know you can't go over there and sit down. Another might be scared for their life and shoot. It's already in effect.
All right, y'all got a lot of things on your mind, right? I see, y'all got a lot of stuff on y'all's mind.
Now I'm going to be quiet. Back to Sister Irene's point. She mentioned that what maybe I've said to somebody, who's one person, not the other. I remember my mother-in-law, your stepmother, used to say when I first got saved, she said she used to really love jewelry and when she was sitting up in church, this was a praying woman too. She said when she first got saved, she was thinking about her earrings and her jewelry, and it became a hindrance to her. And so she took off all her jewelry. But she was careful to say, if it's not bothering you, then it's not a problem for you. You know, like I wear jewelry and I don't even think about it that I have it on. I just like, But you know, if I'm sitting here thinking about, oh, well, I wonder how my earrings look, or how this look and all that, that's a hindrance. And if I'm doing that and not listening to the word, and you know, praising, getting into praise and worship. So I think that's kind of what Sister Irene, was that kind of what you were saying?
Because I thought it was the scripture said, again, I think it says something to the, I need to search it now, but it says, if it's sin unto you, it's sin. And I use that reason why I remember, because, you know, hey, back in the day, church died Christ by the pain.
Yes.
And I said, but I've been renewed. To me, that's not a sin anymore.